Well, good evening. Good to have you with us at our midweek Bible study tonight. Tonight I want to answer a couple of questions that have been raised and sent to me, a couple of questions on our series, our Sunday morning series on the book of Exodus. So the first question is, why was it Aaron and not Moses that changed the staff into the snake in front of Pharaoh? Great question. So thank you to the person that has sent that in. I think it was because Moses and Aaron were a team pair sent by God to Pharaoh. Because the Bible really has them very much together in their approach to Pharaoh, and also after they leave Egypt in leading the people out of Egypt throughout the wilderness. Now, it has to be said, Aaron, even though he was the older brother, was acting under Moses' instruction, because God would speak to Moses and then Moses would speak to Aaron and tell him what to do. So Aaron's authority was a very much delegated authority. It did seem at the very start that God wanted Moses alone to be the one to approach Pharaoh and to perform the signs and throw down the staff and all of that, but Moses really, really did not want to do it. He offered all sorts of excuses and finally to concede because he felt he couldn't speak well enough, God told him that he would send Aaron with him to do it. Let me just give you the verse for that. Exodus 4, 14 to 16. Then the Lord's anger burned against Moses and he said, "What about your brother Aaron the Levite? I know he can speak well. So he's already on his way to you and he will be glad to see you. You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth and I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. He will speak to the people for you and you. It will be as if he were your mouth and as if you were God to him." So hopefully that answers that question. And incidentally, it shows us... you didn't ask this, but it shows us that teamwork is really, really much at the heart of God's work. The work of the church could not be done today without the many volunteers who give of their time and talent, gifting to serve the Lord. And it also shows us that no one person is good at everything. In some areas we're weak, in some areas we're strong. And so God wants those areas that he has gifted us, he wants to use us in those areas, to build up the church in those areas that we're gifted in. So hopefully that helps. Thank you for the question. Keep sending them in. The second question is a little bit more complicated. It's to explain a short passage that we see also in Exodus chapter 4. It's three verses. So let me just give you the context before I read the passage. Moses has just met with God at the burning bush, and after much resistance and many excuses, he's finally said yes to God's command to return to Egypt to bring the message to Pharaoh to let the Israelites go. So together with his wife, Zipporah, and his firstborn son, Gershom, they're on their way to Egypt. And somewhere along the way, at a lodging place, something very strange happens to him. Let me read the text, chapter 4, verses 24 to 26. At a lodging place on the way, the Lord met Moses and was about to kill him. But Zipporah took a flint knife, she cut off her son's foreskin and touched Moses' feet with it. "Surely you are a bridegroom of blood to me," she said. So the Lord let him alone. At the time, she said, "bridegroom of blood," referring to circumcision. So this is really, really hard to understand, because God, who has just commissioned Moses to serve him, is now trying to kill him. The God who demonstrated such patience with him in bearing with his excuses and reluctance to go, now that he has gone, it seems is about to strike him dead. It's just hard to get our heads around that one. And to be fair, every theologian that I have read has had their struggles with this passage. And so the person who asked this question to me to explain this passage, he kind of thought it was Aaron who wanted Moses dead. Now, Aaron's Moses' brother, who was on his way to meet him. I don't think that that's the case, because the text doesn't actually say that, and it clearly does say that it was God who was trying to kill him. So why? And why did the act of circumcision on Gershom, Moses' firstborn son, save his father? And furthermore, what does it mean to us today? Well, to try and answer that, or explain it and answer it, let me try and say what I see in this passage. On Saturday nights, we as a family sit down and we usually watch Catchphrase, and one of the well-worn phrase, you know, to get what Mr. Chips is doing, you have to say what you see. So here's what I see in this passage. Let me just pull it out. Besides God, there are three people in this scene. There's Moses, Zipporah, and Gershom. God, without warning, it seems, was about to kill Moses. What did that look like? Well, we're not told. Perhaps Moses fell to the ground, writhing in pain. Perhaps he was, I don't know, but it looked like he was going to die. But he didn't kill him, which leads me to think that this was more a message that God wanted to get to Moses than a mission to end his life. Because, believe me, if God wanted to kill somebody, he could just do it outright. What else do we see? Well, we see Zipporah acting quickly. Somehow she knew what to do. How? We're not told, but it involves circumcising their son. And so what we can also say that their son, up to that point anyway, hadn't been circumcised. And what we also know is that as a child of a Hebrew man, he should have been. Circumcision was the Old Testament mark of belonging to the family of God, the people of God. God gave it to Abraham long ago and commanded him that every male child in his family should have it and throughout their descendants. So that ought to have been done, but wasn't. What else do we see? Well, Zipporah takes the piece of skin, of cut skin, and she touches Moses' feet with it. By the way, circumcision wasn't the mother's role, it was the father's role. So the failure to circumcise Gershom was Moses' failure. It really was down to him. He hadn't done it when he should have, and he couldn't do it there and then because he was incapacitated. What else do we see or hear? Well, we hear the words that Zipporah utters. Surely you are a bridegroom of blood to me. Now, I'm led to believe that this is not an angry statement, nor is it a negative statement. Believe it or not, it's an endearing statement. We wouldn't necessarily put it in a Valentine card today, but back then they might have. It was a phrase that expressed an intimate bond. Now, the closest thing I can think of is that Moses, we are one flesh. So, following the actions and words of Zipporah, the Lord let Moses alone. The grip of death had passed, and then after that, he continued on his way to Egypt. Zipporah and Gershom wouldn't have. The child would have needed time to heal. And then I think Zipporah and Gershom would have, instead of going to Egypt, would have went back to Jethro, her father, in Midian. So that's what we see, but what does it mean? Well, here's what I believe this passage means. I believe that God, in his mercy, was righting a wrong in Moses' life. You see, Moses was the son of the covenant and was on his way to deliver the children of the covenant, Israel, from a man who held them in his grip. He would be the servant of Almighty God to pronounce the plagues upon the land of Egypt, including the most severe of them all, the taking of the firstborn son of Egypt. Here's just a couple of verses before this episode that announces what God was going to do. Chapter 4, verses 21 to 23. The Lord had said to Moses, when you return to Egypt, see that you perform before Pharaoh all the wonders I've given you the power to do, but I will harden his heart so that he will not let the people go. Then said to Pharaoh, this is what the Lord says, Israel is my firstborn son, and I told you, let my son go so that he may worship me. But you refuse to let him go, so I will kill your firstborn son. So the final penalty for Egypt's disobedience would be the death of their firstborn son. And yet here is Moses in disobedience for failing to circumcise his own firstborn son, bringing that message, pronouncing that judgment on other families. He, as leader of God's people, needed to get his house in order. And it wasn't until that action was taken, the bloody skin of tissue, cast at Moses' feet and those words uttered, surely you're a bridegroom of blood to me, that the wrath of God for Moses' disobedience subsided. That may sound extreme to us and highly dramatic, but we have to take it seriously as God's word to us. And perhaps as well, this action was taken with Gershom in mind also. You see, when the destroying angel was passing throughout Egypt, taking the lives of all those children, what would have happened in Moses' home had he not been circumcised? I don't know, would Gershom have been taken as well? So, what does it mean to us today? Well, let me suggest two things. One, the importance of baptism, and two, the significance of blood. Let me take a moment on baptism first. Why baptism? Well, baptism has replaced circumcision. Baptism is the New Testament sign of the covenant, the people of the covenant. It's a command of the Lord that the people of the Lord and their children be baptized. So we can say this from this passage. It warrants that professing Christians take the sacrament of baptism seriously. Now, baptism doesn't save us, we know that, but it is a command from the Lord and it's one that we are to obey. So let me ask those who are watching us, if you're a professing believer and are not baptized, can I say that you should be? It's a command. It's a command we're to obey. We're to believe and be baptized. And your obedience grows increasingly important as we progress in the Christian faith. The more we mature, the more obedience is expected. That's the first baptism. Let me spend a moment just on blood. The touching of blood upon Moses averted God's divine wrath and saved his firstborn son. Surely that points us to the atoning work of Jesus Christ. He, the firstborn son of the Father, shed his blood, that blood by which a sinner is saved. Hebrews 9:22 tells us that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Just as it took Gershom's blood to turn away the wrath of God and Moses, so too it takes Jesus' blood to save us from the wrath of God, from our many sins. Folks, that's my two thoughts on that particular and difficult passage. I submit them to you. I would suggest that this strange text points us to Christ and calls us to obedience to him. Let's pray. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace and mercy. I thank you that just in the study of this little passage, we find a command to obey, and we also see Christ, whose blood was shed on our behalf. We pray that you'd bless this word to us and help us continue, Lord, following you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore, our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Was the cost we stood near.